sit and wait. There's an angel contemplate my fate. And do they know the places where we go when we're gray and old? 'Cause I have been told that salvation lets their wings unfold. So when I'm lying in my bed, thoughts running through my head, and I feel that love is dead, I'm loving angels instead. And through it, oh, she offers me protection, a lot of love and affection, whether I'm right or wrong. And down the waterfall, wherever it may take me, I know that life won't break me. When I come to call, she won't forsake me. I'm loving angels instead. When I'm feeling weak and my pain walks down a one-way street, I look above and I know I'll always be blessed with love. And as the feeling grows, she breathes flesh to my bones. When love is dead, I'm loving angels instead. And through it,
estate and to the atmospheric Lindsay Room, where we've gathered to witness and celebrate the marriage of Grant and Elaine. Some of you may not have attended a civil marriage ceremony before, And I'm fairly certain that even if you have, it will not have been in a more beautiful setting, or indeed with a more attractive bridal party. For those of you who are unfamiliar with, you can pay me for that one. For those of you who are unfamiliar with civil marriages, I thought I should explain a little bit about today's ceremony. This may sound obvious, but the essential difference between getting married in a church by a minister and being married by a registrar is that a civil marriage performed by a registrar has no religious significance. Today, therefore, we will have no hymns, no sermons, but Grant and Elaine will still make their marriage vows and declare their love for one another before you, their friends and family. In my capacity as Assistant Registrar for the District of Fife, I have been appointed by the Registrar General for Scotland as a person authorised to solemnise civil marriages in accordance with the provisions of the Marriage Scotland Act 1977. Before I proceed, it is necessary that you identify yourselves by answering the following questions. Are you Grant Miller Thorburn of 161 Rosebank Avenue, Falkirk?
I am.
Are you Elaine Dorothy Baxter of the same address?
I am.
We're now assembled here in order that I may solemnise your marriage in the presence of these witnesses, Blair and Diane, in accordance with the law of Scotland. I can confirm that the requirements of that law, preliminary to your marriage, have been satisfied, and that you are both aware of the legal impediments to marriage. Before you, Grant, and you, Elaine, are joined in marriage, it is my duty to remind you of the binding character of the vows you're about to make. Marriage, according to law of this country, is a union of one man with one woman, voluntarily entered into for life, to the exclusion of all others. It is a way of life that all should honour and must not be undertaken lightly or selfishly, but respectfully, responsibly, and after serious thought. Once in a lifetime, you find someone who touches not only your heart, but also your soul. Once in a lifetime, you find someone who stands beside you, not over you. You find someone who loves you for who you are and not for who you could be. Once in a lifetime, you find someone as you have found one another. Before we proceed to hear Grant and Elaine exchange their vows, I would like to ask Grant's dad, Ian, to come forward, please.
You still have my speech here, am I? The act of marriage. If you consider in marriage, the little things can be the big things. Yeah? Such as, it's never too old to hold hands. It is remembering to say I love you at least once a day. It is never going to sleep angry. It is at no time taking the other for granted. The courtship should never end with the honeymoon. It should last throughout the year. It is having a mutual sense of values and common objectives. It is standing together facing the world. It is forming a circle of love that gathers in the whole family. It is doing things for each other, not in the attitude of duty or sacrifice, but in the spirit of joy. It is speaking words of appreciation and demonstrating gratitude in thoughtful ways. It is not expecting the husband to wear a halo or the wife to have wings of an angel. It is not looking for perfection in each other. It is cultivating flexibility, understanding and a sense of humour. It is having the capacity to forgive and forget. It is giving each other the atmosphere in which to grow. I'm nearly finished. It is finding room for things of the spirit. It is a common search for the good and the beautiful. It is establishing a relationship in which the independence is equal, dependence is mutual, and the obligation is reciprocal. That was a hard bit. It is not only marrying the right person, the right partner is being the right partner. a little bit of fatherly advice. Be prepared to eat humble pie. The lady is always right.
Your dad knows what he's talking about. Let us now proceed to hear, receive and register the vows of marriage made in the presence of myself and these witnesses, Blair and Diane, in accordance with the law of the land. Can I ask everybody to please be standing? Okay. Can you repeat after me first, okay? I grant. Solemnly and sincerely declare.
Solemnly and sincerely declare.
That I know of no legal impediment.
That I know of no legal impediment.
To my marrying Elaine.
To my marrying Elaine.
I, Elaine. Solemnly and sincerely declare.
Solemnly and sincerely declare.
That I know of no legal impediment.
That I know of no legal impediment.
To my marrying Grant.
To my marrying Grant.
Now, this is the tricky bit, because the flowers are being passed. Stop it. Okay. You okay?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, Grant, you go first. Okay. You remember you've seen this too. Okay. I solemnly and sincerely declare.
That I grant.
I accept you, Elaine. As my lawful wedded wife. To the exclusion of all others. I promise to love you. To honour and to cherish you always. Elaine. I solemnly and sincerely declare.
That I, Elaine.
Accept you, Grant. As my lawful wedded husband. To the exclusion of all others. I promise to love you. To honour and cherish you always. As a seal to the contract into which you're both entering, these rings are given and received. Blair, can I ask you to present Grant with the ring that he's giving to Elaine? Grant, place it on Elaine's finger. And repeat after me. As a seal to my vow.
I give you this ring.
Let it be a sign.
Of our marriage and love.
And can you give Elaine the ring that she's giving to you? As a seal to my vow.
I give you this ring.
Let it be a sign. Of our marriage and love. Now, would the people with seats please be seated, please? Can I ask Elaine's dad, Forbes, to come forward, please?
On your wedding day, today is a day you will always remember, the greatest in anyone's life. You'll start off the day with just as two people in love and end it as husband and wife. It's a brand new beginning, the start of a journey with moments to cherish and treasure. And although there'll be times when you both disagree, these will surely be outweighed by pleasure. You'll have heard many words of advice in the past when the secrets of marriage were spoken, but you know that the answers lie hidden inside where the bond of true love lies unbroken. So live happy forever as lovers and friends. It's the dawn of a new life for you as you stand there together with love in your eyes from the moment you whisper, "I do." And with luck, all your hopes and your dreams can be real. May success find its way to your hearts. Tomorrow can bring you the greatest of joys, but today is the day it all starts.
Thank you. future may hold, may your union be part of it. It will have hopes and disappointments, successes and failures, pleasures and pain, but love can soften every blow. May your love never fail, but grow deeper and stronger as the years pass. Following the binding declaration which you've made before me, in the presence of these witnesses, Diane and Blair, I hereby declare that you, Grant, and you, Elaine, are now husband and wife. You kiss her now, Phil.
Before I start the actual speech, I've been asked by one or two ladies if they should keep their hats on or take their hats off. So it's up to yourself. If you feel comfortable with your hats off, just take them off. If you feel comfortable with your hats off, whatever you like. Right. I've only got a wee speech today. It goes to about 56 pages. So, it'll be a long time before ye. Okay. As tradition seems to dictate, it falls on my shoulders to open today's round of speeches. I'll be fairly brief. In fact, I'll be as brief as I possibly can. Keep your hand back on. Go on, take it off. Now, where should I begin meeting my beautiful daughter, Elaine? Squirm a little apprehensively about what secrets I'm about to reveal. Can't hear me! Sorry! Okay, where should I begin making my beautiful daughter Elaine more than a little apprehensive about what secrets I'm about to reveal? Well, Elaine, you can relax. I'm not letting any cats out of the bag. Maybe just a few kittens. Quite a number of years ago, there was a very questionable, highly questionable pop singer named David Essex. And he was born in Howard Shore Maternity Hospital, Plastow, in the East End of London. And it just so happens that one of his greatest fans was also born there. Elaine. My little Cockney Sparrow. And she is a Cockney. Bet you didn't know. Born and part-bred within the sound of bow bells, or to be more precise, an area dedicated as such. But you wouldn't guess by her accent now, eh? To say that as a kiddie, Elaine was a delight would be a gross misunderstatement. She was the happiest, smiliest, chubby-faced little cherub ever a pure delight, an absolute treasure. Except for once, perhaps. Remember the dentist, Elaine? She required an extraction to let some of her other teeth grow through. Okay. Into the dentist. Into the chair. Injection into the gums. Not a murmur, not a bit of bother. Spies, the pliers, oh no you don't. You're not on, Polly, I'm off. And she did. Poor little thing got caught. But it all ended well. So time marched on a bit and the state of habit, we came back to Aberdeen from London. She went through her school years beautifully, not a hint of bother. Then went to college to be a medical secretary. Worked in general practice for a while, although, sorry Elaine, on her way to work one morning, she considered changing her job and becoming an entomologist. But she decided fairly soon afterwards, not for me, I don't like these little beasties. Now you may like to ask her about that time. If you do, perhaps you should do so by phone, as the reply you'll receive will probably be loud and brutal. Sorry. Okay. I've just done myself no end of favour, by the way. Eventually, she went to work as a secretary for Professor Bunt in the gastroenterology department in the hospital. But it wasn't long until she told the prof, I'm going to try and get into nursing. The prof immediately concurred with her and I believe gave her a glowing reference. But did ask her, are you not happy here, Elaine? Oh aye, smashing job, but see the smell of poo all the time. She became a nurse. So she went to nursing college, did her training again, sailed through it. God only knows how she does it. I've no got brains. Then she started dating. Nobody ever came up to her required standard. Until one day I got, Dad, I've met the guy that ticks all the right boxes for me. My instant thought was, I'll swing for him. However, along she came, Dad, Grant's coming up to meet you. What do you mean coming up to meet? Well, He lives in Falkirk. What a place. Full of drunken nurses. Full of drunken nurses. Fee? Where's Fee? Where am I? I've lost my plot now. Where? Oh, hi. Hello, Fee.
Hello, Mr. Buster.
Okay. So, you know. Do you want to come up here and do this? You know, it's a bit of a blow when one of your babies tells you she's moving out. But she wasn't even staying in Aberdeen. So I thought, I was going to try and blow this guy out of the water. But I must confess, I'd only met him for an extremely short time when it became obvious he was a really, really nice bloke. And I'd absolutely no problems letting Elaine move away with him. And so far, I've never had any doubts whatsoever. We've had our drunken times together. We shared some golf lessons, for which I've never yet been paid.
Take you home last, it's that good.
He walked me into a wall. He walked me right into a wall. I had the most horrendous scar up here. I woke up in the morning, going, what's that? And then he tells me I walked into a wall. Shows the state I was in. His fault. Okay. Where am I? Oh, aye. When I met him, I say, he walks in, kicks off his reviling smelling trainers. He strolls himself out along the sofa. Great big cheesy grin in his face. See? He's doing it. So, off they went, just in time for Elaine, on the day she was to start work at Falkirk Infirmary. Falkirk Infirmary! To smash her ankle and end up a patient in her own ward. That's when, in my eyes, Grant came into the room. Everything she wanted, Grant. He was wonderful. The next thing I really liked about him, see, I told you it was 56 pages. Grant, with a rather sheepish look on his face, formally asked me for Elaine's hand in marriage. That was a move which I really liked, and showed that he is extremely well-mannered, despite his smelly trainers. Right, not much more to say, except, as some of you will know, Grant has quite a reputation for having a really boozy barbecue each year. But hell's teeth, Grant, you've really pushed the boat out this year, haven't you? Now into my penultimate paragraph. There are two very, very, very lovely people here today that, well, although Elaine isn't at the other side of the world, it's heartening for her mum and I to know that these people have been, and I'm certain always will be, near at hand for her in any tight corners. I refer, of course, to Eileen. Dorothy and I want to wish you, or to thank you, very, very much. Really. You've been wonderful to her. Okay, well now at the end. Would you please, I don't know where this saying came from, but it's right. Would you please charge your glasses, stand, and drink a toast to my beautiful daughter Elaine and her extremely handsome husband Grant. The toast is the bride and groom.
Bride and groom. Bride and groom. Bride and groom. First of all, I'd like to say thanks to both of those kind words. I hope I can live up to your expectations and be as good a husband to Elaine as you've been a father. Anyway, on behalf of my wife and I, I've been given permission for probably the first time and undoubtedly the last time to speak on behalf of both of us.
I did warn you this morning, didn't I?
There's a few people I'd like to say thank you to, first of all. Mum and Dad, Ford and Dorothy, who I guess I can now call Mum and Dad as well. Thank you to both of you for your kindness and your generosity. Without the assistance you've given us today, there's no way we'd be sitting in a place like this with so many of our friends and family. So thank you very much to both of you. It's a small gesture of that. We've got a bouquet of flowers for both sets of mum, which are coming around just shortly. They are coming, but I believe... Ah, I've spotted them in the corner there. Thank you. Also want to say thank you to my gran, whose generosity again has helped pay for today. And my gran also bought us our wedding rings for us, so thanks very much, gran. Diane, Mandy, Blair, our bridesmaids and my best man, thank you for all your assistance over the last few weeks. As you know, it got fairly stressful at certain times, but they've always been at the end of the phone for us and they've been a great assistance, so thank you very much to Ollie for that. And also to Lily, I can hear Lily, wherever she is. Thank you for just being Lily wherever you are. You're the most gorgeous flower girl we could ever ask for, and you've been brilliant today, so she's probably hiding under the table or clapping hands, or if there's a wee boy, I see a wee boy in the back, Lily's probably chasing her. Okay. Bill and Adam here at the castle, the stress of taking, you've just taken everything out of our hands, you've been brilliant. I couldn't ask for better hosts, absolutely brilliant. You prepared the venue today, just gorgeous. It doesn't seem like 2 years ago since we first met, but it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much, Bill. And to every single one of you, what can we say? The generosity you've all shown us with our guests has just been incredible. We've been overwhelmed with the gifts, so thank you very much to every single one of you. I want to also mention a few people who have travelled far today. First of all, to my sister Kim. Kim's came over, she works in Spain now, so Kim's travelled over for the weekend to be with us. And it's the first time I've seen her since she got a promotion to a resort supervisor, so congratulations, Kim. John, Fi and Kate, who have come all the way from Cardiff, thank you to see their granddaughter be a flower girl, thank you for travelling so far. And without doubt, those who have travelled for this, Carol, Cameron, Callum, all the way from Washington to be with us today. So I guess as tradition dictates, I tell you a bit about how I met Elaine. The truth is, it all started at my best man's wedding 4 and a bit years ago. We're sitting down at the end of the night, and Blair said to me, I was going to meet someone special very soon. Little did I know that a week later, I'd be in another friend's stag doing the Bex Bar in Aberdeen. slightly intoxicated, and trying to look cool while holding onto a pole. But Elaine reached across the desk and shook my hand, and that was it. Really, it was Mandy. Mandy was the catalyst that night and put us together. I seem to remember getting shoved to the bar and told to buy her a drink immediately. And then another one, and then another one. I think it ended up with £30 worth of drinks and you done most of it, if I remember. So, Mandy, you are a massive pro in us being here today. I really believe if it wasn't for you, we wouldn't have been together. You've been there for us in the odd bad time that we've had. And I now consider you my best friend in law as well. So it started off a kind of long distance relationship, you know, 130 odd miles away. We can't just jump in the car and see each other, so we run up a few phone bills. Eventually, 4 weeks later, I decided to make the trip back up to Aberdeen, and we booked into a restaurant in Aberdeen. Now, some people might call me romantic. Kept the receipt from that night. Here, <it's> here. The truth is, Elaine's not paid her half of the bill yet.
How much was it?
So just to give you an insight into that night, I had the suit and some pasta, 3 pints of lager, and was getting brave of vodka and cola. We then come on to Elaine's side. Now, bear in mind, Elaine was a wee bit nervous. Elaine had deep-fried mozzarella. She also had a chicken pasta. Started off in a fresh orange lemonade, then a cola, then 1, 2, 3 bottles of house wine. Worse though, we staggered out of there into Franklin's, and I tried to match Elaine drink for drink. Now, bearing in mind, she had just had 3 bottles of wine. My overriding memory of the evening was passing out in the dance floor, and Elaine slapping me in the face and carrying me home in a taxi. I keep getting reminded about that every time, about how she got me home. So somehow or other, we made it onto the second date, and that was at one of my famous barbecues, as was mentioned earlier on. Elaine came down the night before, and I have to say, my house has never been so clean or looked so good. Thanks, Mum. But we hit it off really well, and we just knew right from the start that I think we were meant to be together. So here we are, just over 4 years after we met, and she's made me the happiest man in the world today. I thought she was absolutely. I really couldn't have asked for anything else today. It's just been an amazing day. So thanks, Elaine.
Right.
Finally! Finally, I'd just like to thank our bridesmaids again. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please raise your glasses to toast our bridesmaids.
The bridesmaids.
The bridesmaids. It's that part of the night again where most grooms get slightly nervous as they pass over their best man. The truth is, I've led such a clean, almost virginal lifestyle that I have no worries. So we've been best mates at school, I'm still his best mate, but he's still my best mate, despite what he done to me in the stag do, which I'm sure he'll elaborate on.
Don't worry. I forgot the most important part of my speech. I do apologise, this is most unusual. The most important part was for myself to welcome Grant into the Baxter family. And I do welcome you into the family, Grant.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think on occasions such as this, nerves do play a very important part. And it's, at the end of the day, it's the meaning behind it and the thought that comes from the heart that matters. I'd like to ask Blair now to reply on behalf of the bridesmaids and read a few telegrams. Who can, Blair?
Afternoon, everyone. I knew I was going to have difficulty following that speech by Grant, and I was right. I couldn't follow a bloody word. It's with great pleasure that I respond to Grant's toast on behalf of the bridesmaids. And also, I'd like to thank Grant very much for that. I'd also like to thank Grant very much for allowing me to be his best man. Thanks very much for allowing me to play a part in such a wonderful day. As Grant mentioned, a couple of months ago, he said to me, "You'll never, ever have anything on me. I've never done anything embarrassing in my life." You can tell me that in 10 minutes. We'll see. As you know, it's traditional for the best man to dress the same as the groom, so I thought I'd take it a step further this year, and I've been receiving special treatment. So, I have a hairy shirt. I need to take that off, it's just been sweating. There you go, it's down there now. Grant is the hairiest man I know. However, I couldn't believe it. He came in the other day, I went over to his house the other day, and he told me he just had an all over body wax. Which is true, and he'll show you later on. Darlene, I was a wee bit worried tonight. I wasn't sure if you would really know it was Grant. So, I've got a present for you to put on him, so that he feels the same. Make sure you put it on him now, okay. So he feels the same. I'll give you it back. Hold on. Okay. Before even starting my speech, I had a few things that I couldn't say. So obviously things I can't mention are Grant's early taste in music, which was Cliff Richard. Phoning his mum from Scarborough after playing a game of football, he'd just scored 2 goals, but he was 22 at the time. I must have been, you're right. Verbally abusing Gordon Hunter, a former Hibs player in an Edinburgh pub. His antics while in France during the World Cup in 98. And finally, his obsession with the calendar girls, who are special dancers. And I'm not saying any more. So that's just a few highlights. Let's move on to some more juicy details. Grant's mum tells me from the day he was born he cried for 6 months, solid, and didn't sleep until he was 1.
That was 21.
21. By the time he was 10, he had decided he no longer needed to wash. I know. Grant's mum tells me he used to get up for school every morning and go into the bathroom and would pretend to wash. And every time his mum used to, when he came out the bathroom, his mum used to say, "Have you washed?" "Yes, yes, I've washed." So Eileen one morning went in and stole the shampoo and the soap. And Grant went in as normal and came out and she said, "Have you washed this morning?" And he said, "Yes."
So. Right, give me the flowers back. That's only the start.
Wait, is
Granny
wet
the towel?
It was at high school that I first met Grant. It was probably about 5th or 6th year when we got friendly. At that point in time, he was truly the life and soul of the common room. And I'm sure everyone at school would remember him. Probably the biggest memory I have from Grant at that point in time was that he was learning to drive. And he used to come into the common room before going out for a lesson, and he used to pick up a steering wheel, and he used to pretend to drive and make engine noises before going out for his lesson. I don't know how that helped him to drive, I don't know. I don't know how many times it took you to pass. 4 or 5, was it? After that, I have many memories of Grant from our first holidays together, from our first cars, from his barbecue and his famous punch. I don't know how many know about that. And I have many, many more. That probably leads me on to the most embarrassing moment, I think, in Grant's life. Come on, sweat. Grant was out one night with his friends and went back to one of his mates, Danny's, to stay. Now, I wasn't there, so the story goes, the rumours go, they had company, but I am not sure. All I'll say on the subject is that Grant got in the middle of the night to get a drink of water and stood on a glass. He badly injured his foot and was rushed to hospital with nothing other than a skin-tight pair of shorts on, blood everywhere, and I think he was in hospital for a good few weeks and a long time to fully walk after it. However, I'm not sure what his most embarrassing moment is, explaining to his mum or getting bed-bathed by his mate's wife. And she is here today. I won't say any more. Moving on to the stag night, it was a great weekend. We had two rounds of golf on the Friday. She's over there in case you don't know yet. Who was the winner?
I would never have married her if I'd
been cheaper.
Moving on to the stag weekend, we had two rounds of golf on the Friday, which Craig won. I don't know how, he's a bandit. It was a fix. And on the Saturday we went to Newcastle for the night. It was a busy weekend in Newcastle. There was horse racing and a few other things on, and I had real difficulty booking accommodation. It must have been about 40 odd phone calls, without a doubt. I eventually got somewhere. In fact, I got two places. It was seven in each. So we arrived there on the Saturday about 5 o'clock. There was a few of us there: Craig, Robbo, Barry, Grant, of course. And it was about 5 o'clock. We were half cut and we were in and out. But when I got there, there was something just not right. I wasn't sure what it was about the hotel. Having had a few drinks, didn't bother, went out, had the night out and all the rest of it, and came back the next day, checked out, and went into the hotel next door where the rest were. And I think it was Grant, I can't remember. Somebody went to the bar anyway, and the barman said, "Where did you stay last night?" And we said, "The Hedgefield Hotel next door." The guy fell about laughing and announced to us that it's a gay-only hotel. So we had stayed in a gay-only hotel. However, it gets worse. I got home about 2 o'clock in the morning and I wasn't with Grant. However, Grant was with Simi. My lasting memory from that weekend was getting home at 2 in the morning to find Grant and Simi lying on the floor, sleeping, cuddling each other. Now, I just wondered if they knew at that point or not. I'm not sure. Yeah. Moving on to Grant's love life. For a long time, we did think that Grant would be married to his mum for the rest of his life. Those of you that know Grant knows, and Eileen know, that she does everything for him. Everything for him. Even when he moved out, she used to come round and she used to do all his housework, as he's mentioned already. That's quite interesting, actually. The first time we went away on holiday together, we had a major dilemma. And all I'm going to say on that subject is I'm glad I wasn't the one that drew the short straw to wipe his bum for a fortnight.
That's my boy.
As Grant mentioned, 4 years ago, almost to the day, myself and Louise got married, and that's when I did say these words of wisdom to Grant. I was very drunk at the time, obviously. However, yeah, within a week or so, he'd met Elaine, and the rest is history, as they say. So, take away earlier words, Elaine, you look stunning today, and you make Grant a lovely, you're a lovely couple. So.
Thank you.
Thanks, mate.
No bother. I think it's also important to recognise how brave was of Elaine to move down to Falkirk from her parents and all the rest of it. So, but in retrospect, Elaine, I'm not sure if you'd done it as soon if you'd known you'd had to wipe his bum. I don't know how many of yous have noticed how Grant and Elaine show their affection. I have. They hit each other quite often. It's quite interesting, that, actually. So a few weeks ago, I dropped by the house and they were having a small disagreement. And Elaine threw Grant's clothes out the upstairs window. And Grant was wearing them at the time.
Oh,
Owen, I'm really happy that you found each other. Grant's a true friend and I'm over the moon that you've met somebody to spend the rest of his life with. The one other thing I can't go by without mentioning is Grant's other love. Any ideas? His other love? One other love? Hearts, yes, it's hearts, yeah, of course. I don't know, a team that's won what? One honour in the last, what, how many years? 50, 100, I don't know.
It's important to be a
part. Absolutely. I do believe there's many positives that you can take from Grant's relationship with Hearts, but Elaine, one is kind of words that spring to mind are committed or even obsessed. Not quite sure. Loyal to the co-op, and would do anything for them. So, Elaine, I'm sure if he behaves half towards you as he has towards Hearts, then you'll be very happy together. Leading on to a few cards, then. Just going to read out a few cards from close family and absent friends. There is a table that's got all the other cards up, and we thank you very much for them, but I would have been here all night and I'm sure these are all getting hungry, so I won't keep you too much longer. Just a few. First one is to Mum and Dad.
Becky.
Congratulations on tying the knot. Sorry I couldn't be with you today, however, the excitement would have been too much. Have a wonderful day. Love, Becky. Woof, woof. To Grant and Elaine, so you've done it. You've married Elaine. I think she deserves a medal. I'm glad to see someone's got sense. No wedding at your beloved Tynecastle, however. Seriously, though, both enjoy your day. It's one that you will treasure. To pass on this message of congratulations, give us so much pleasure. To the happy couple on this fine day, we send our thoughts to you, although we are distant and can't be there. Lots of love for the future, Stuart and Zoe. With very best wishes and lots of love, Fiona. Dear Grant and Elaine, wishing you lots of luck and happiness, lots of love, Kim. It's a telegram, the one and only telegram. To Grant, from Susie Wong in Thailand. Hey, big boy. How come you no write no more? How come you no send no money no more? When you come back to Bangkok, the kids will miss you very much. Love, Susie. To Elaine and Grant, best wishes to both of you from Auntie Betty. To Elaine and Grant, what more could we wish for you, Mum and Dad Baxter? This is a special homemade card. To Grant and Elaine. Dear Elaine and Grant, our wish for you today is that your love for each other brings you a lifetime of happiness. All our love, Mum and Dad. To Elaine and Grant, with lots of love and best wishes, John, Diane and Lily. From Aunt Avril and Uncle Alec. For a special grandson and his wife. Wishing you lots of love and happiness in your life together. Love from Grant. To Grant and Elaine. Congratulations on your wedding day. From the best team in Edinburgh. Best wishes from Tom Farmer, Tony Mowbray and the Hibs team. Yes, enclosed as a signed team photo. From the other love in your life, best wishes from all at Llanlifco and District Hearts Supporters Club. Signed GBH, whatever that means. Don't know. Finally, what a great day it's been so far. I'm sure we'll all agree it's been wonderful. It could not have worked out any better, and it's down to the hard work of both Grant and Elaine, who have organised everything. On behalf of the guests, Grant and Elaine, we'd like to thank you for sharing this wonderful day with us. Finally, now all that remains for me to do is to ask you all to stand with your glasses charged. And join me in wishing Grant and Elaine all the love, health and happiness in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the bride and groom.
The bride and groom.
If we'd like, I don't know where they are, they're hiding somewhere, or they're behind. The bride and groom, the new Mr. and Mrs. Thurbin, if they can take the floor please for the first waltz. And a big round of applause for the ladies and gentlemen watching them there. They've requested their first dance to be played on CD, and it's Dido, thank you. So, here we go with the first waltz. Feel to start us off.
I
so in love with you. I do what you want to do. It's all right with me. Together.
faith pours from your walls, drowning your calls. I've tried to hear, you're not near. Remembering when I saw your face shining my way, pure timing. Now I've fallen in deep, slow, silent sleep. It's killing me, I'm dying. A little bit of sunshine in your life. Soleil all over you, warm sun pours over me. Soleil all over you, warm sun. Now this slick fallen rift came like a gift. Your body moves ever nearer. Now that we're here, and grief for me, not history. But now I'm dry of thoughts, wait for the rain, then it's replaced, sun setting.